Right, let's look at operating system basics. And then I'll respond to messages in the chat. Okay, so with regards to, you know, operating system basics, it's more just understanding what type of operating systems is used in the cloud, okay? And so what we look at is just certain things about the operating system and how Linux work, because it's basically about the Linux operating system. So I'm going to go through this, not too long, because this is just the basics, and I think you can all just go through this again. But it's more just understanding, really, how does Linux operate, how you classify it, using Linux as operating system, and some commands that you might need to know as part of Linux. So an operating system have these different components. It needs to maintain understanding the hardware. So when you plug in your keyboard and your mouse into your laptop or your PC, it's the hardware that you're basically plugging in. And then the OS needs to understand really how to translate that. And by doing that, it has these core functions. It has a system call interface, which means it checks what device is connected. It needs to process your programs that run on your PC, so it runs process management. So it's like a task manager. And it also needs to manage your memory, the file system itself, where you store your files, and then as well as your driver. Because if you have a keyboard here, and your keyboard needs to connect, and you need to type on your keyboard, the driver management is very important. And that's why you'll know if you have to install drivers sometimes, it doesn't work because of the driver management feature of the OS. So it has all these core functions to operate. And then it also has an API, which is obviously the application software that deals with it too. So the API would sit normally here. And then that will allow the computer to know, sorry, the operating system to know which application it needs to use and how it needs to save the resources. And then you as the user basically use the application itself. And so forth. That's why you hear something, the term called system software and software. System software is normally what makes the OS work. And then you obviously have the normal software. So that's just basically that. And then obviously when you look at operating system, it has something called a kernel. The kernel is the base of how you define the operating system. And so the kernel can be upgraded because normally your kernel is, like in Windows, it has its own kernel, Linux has its own kernel. And if you need to do sometimes upgrades, you need to upgrade the kernel. And that's basically the main part of your operating system. So looking at different types of OS, we have Unix, which is most common. Unix is more used in server platforms like HP, IBM, and most other OS. And then we have the common Linux. Linux is used with many of these providers. Red Hat, CentOS, Red Hat Enterprise, OpenELO, which is Huawei. And obviously there's Ubuntu also, that's not probably listed here. And then you obviously have Windows, which is obviously Microsoft versions. Now, when we look at Linux, Linux is designed to be a multi-platform, OS. It allows to have multi-user and multitasking. And it's something called a file. It's not like Windows, we call it the file system. Everything is stored as a file. So everything is a file, basically, in Linux. There's no dot, in Windows you have .ddl. I don't like these, .ddl, .exe, all these different extensions. What's the other ones? There's, can't get to the name now. But it's obviously all these different services files that you get on Windows. Whereas with Linux, everything is a file. You have this kind of setup. So you have your root directory, which is the main directory, and you have all these folders, and all these folders basically has a function as into where you would install and store certain things. So you can see here, if you look at Linux, I think I have a Mac, so Mac is similar to Linux, so I'll just show you. So if I, let me just list this, clear, let's say CD, you see all of these are just files. You can see a lot of files here. But I mean, what I'm trying to say is, let me just close that, it's fine, is that when you look at the directory, it has, in Windows, you have like a program file, system program files, and so forth. Linux have a bin for mostly program files. It has a diff file directory for if you want to mount a device. It has a library for system library and certain files. It has a media if you want to mount a USB drive, then it goes under media. And you have, you know, the directory for storing information and an application that you install, which is going into the op directory. The etc is the most, you know, directory that Linux uses. All the configuration files goes in there. And then you obviously have your mount if you need to mount certain devices like NFS. If you need to mount an NFS device, you would then use the mount directory to mount it in that sense. Right, so basically these are just, you know, the basics I'm going through about it. And then OpenELA is Linux Server OS, and what it's there for, it's there to allow you to run, you know, Linux on a server platform. And that's their flavor. And so basically, this is the family of Linux. This just show you how and where it's coming from. So you have Red Hat, which uses Fedora, Red Hat Enterprise, and the free version is CentOS. And then you have Debian and Ubuntu. And then you have OpenELA, which is a community edition. And then obviously the commercial ones is these ones that Huawei runs on the servers. Right, so those are just, you know, the basics of Linux. Then obviously, this is just showing you how Linux operate. It uses also the APIs as a system between the hardware and the software. And also it has these different file systems. Windows, you remember you have Windows, you have NTFS. That's your Windows file system. However, Linux have different file systems, and the reasons beyond that, I have no idea why. So they have the common file system is the ext, which is designed for Linux, right? So ext4 is the latest Linux version of file system. And then you obviously have VFAT, which is normally older one, but it's obviously a way of how you can read Windows files also. So that you would save it as VFAT, your partition, so that you can actually read those files in Linux. So that is that. And then obviously basics of Linux commands. These are just common commands. You have the tab key that you can use in the terminal, and so when you log into Linux, you log in as root or whatever the user would be, and then the password, and then you will be presented with this character which looks like a hash, and that means that you root now. If you see a dollar sign, then you're not root. So that's basically how you difference between who's the admin user and who is the normal user. So those are just examples of how you would change the password. And then this is obviously a normal user. So you can see here, under the ID, it shows a dollar sign, which means that that's now a normal user or one that's operating there and doing configurations on this particular Linux machine. Right, so then obviously we look at some other commands. So you have shutdown, that's if you shut down your PC, reboot, if you want to reboot a PC. And then you have obviously other path values. I'm not gonna go in much in detail with this. These are just how to create a folder, how to create a new file, and how to copy files to directories. And then you also have the moving file. So if you want to move a file, you use the move command. So you just type mv, the file's name, and then here you can see it's being renamed to that. So you're basically renaming the file by using move, the mv command. So you rename it basically to 03 instead of 02. And that's basically how you use Linux. So very careful. These commands are very tricky if you're admin, because you might move a file, give it the wrong name, and then the system doesn't detect it as part of the file. Remove files is delete. So it's RM. And basically, this is just how you delete files. There's a high risk with this command, because you cannot guarantee that you'll get your information back when you use the RM command. And there's obviously the Yelp command to help you with most things. So this is just the text edit in Linux. So you saw earlier, I had this Termus, which I used earlier. Right, so this is like the terminal. But then also, let's say I want to create a file. So let's say I say touch, which is what you saw earlier, that command. Touch, let me just make this bigger. So we have touch, and then you give a file name. So let's say today is Thursday. This is an example. So that's a file name, Thursday, and you don't have to give it extension, because that's the file. So unless it's a config file, you would say config and so forth. So you would just say touch. Now it's created. Okay, now you can go and you do vim. So you can either use vim, which they use here, or vi. So let's use vi for this purpose. So use vi. And then you say that file that you created, Thursday. So what will happen now is it either creates the file for you, or it will just allow you to edit the file. So when I do that, it goes into this editor mode. So you can see now, this is where you can type words and whatever you type in there in that file, okay? In most cases, there would be config files that's in there. So if I wanted to, let's say, today, let me just type today, caps lock is on. Today is Thursday, something like that. That's simple. And you would then have that message saved in that text file. So now what you do is you press escape character and you press colon there. If you can see it at the bottom of the screen, you press WQ for save. And that's the command to save now this file. So if I hit enter, that file is now saved. So if I want to go view the file, to view the file, you would say cat. And that's just to view the file, which is cat, like concatenate. And you say Thursday. So what it will show me now, the contents of the file. So there's the file, the contents that I just created now. And that's basically how you view files in Linux, right? So you use the cat command and then you use Thursday, you know, in this case. So if I wanted to edit the file, I can go in and edit it. If I want to rename the file, I can rename it also. So I can use the move command and say move Thursday, which is the file, and call it 01. Thursday. So now what's going to happen is that, let's call it Thursday. What's going to happen now is it's going to rename that file to 01 Thursday. And now it's renamed. So if I go in VI again for Thursday, it's going to ask me to create a new file because now that file has been renamed. So I don't want to do that. I just want to show you that. And so that's basically what happens when you do the move command and you try to. Somebody saying nothing is being said. Is that true? I thought I'm sharing my screen. Let's see. Hey guys, serious? Did I just talk now and nothing was said? Let me just see. Can you guys see my screen? All right, so they're telling me for the last, what? How long do we speak? Oh, the example wasn't showing. Okay, but could you see the rest of the presentation that I got to from Operating System Basics? All right. Okay, sorry about that. So let me get back to this old screen sharing. Okay. Okay, so as I mentioned earlier, so let me just clear the screen. So when we look at the slides, right, so we covered, okay, the presentation was showing, perfect, thank you. So if we look at this, and it's just to go back there, these were the commands I was basically referring to. You know, list command is to list the viewing directory. The cat was the one to view the common file or the contents of the file. And then I didn't do make directory, but I did a touch command to create a file. And then obviously copy, which I didn't do yet, but then move is the one I looked at. So when we look at, let's just do this over quickly again. So when we look at, you know, the make directory. So let's say mkdir, so use that command and you give it a name. So let's say you say, I'll just call it Thursday. So we create a folder called Thursday. Now, if you want to create a subfolder, you just do this and you then obviously give it a subfolder, then it creates another folder inside that folder. But we'll just make a folder called Thursday and that will be it. Now, if you want to go into that folder, you go CD and you say Thursday. Thursday. And now basically what it will do is it will allow me to go into that folder called Thursday. Wait, it's not spelled wrong. There we go. No man. Why did I type Thursday earlier? No such file. What did I type earlier? I said, oh, the S is missing. How did I spell Thursday wrong? Okay, let's just fix that. It's fine. Let's just do over. Because I think I didn't want to do wrong. So let's call it Thursday properly. See, the directory is created. Yeah, I saw it now. And then you basically CD into Thursday. Now you're into that folder. As you can see, there's the folder. Right, so now, because we do the list command, we can see what's in that folder. There's nothing. If you want to list in detail, you can list AL. And then it shows you there's nothing in that folder, right? And it shows you who's the owner or the group user who this, you know, this folder belongs to, which is now in case me. And then if I now want to create a file, then I just say touch. And I can say test one. And I can give it an extension if I want to, .txt or .log, whatever it is. But I just call it test one. And if I view it again, now you can see test one has been created. Now, if I want to now actually see really, can I add contents to test one? There's two ways to do it. You can do an echo command, which is echo, but we're not going to go into detail of that. You can just basically do the vi or vim for that matter. So I'll use vi for now. And then you say test one. So now basically it will edit test one. And then you can just put anything in there. Whatever you type in there will be there, right? And so that's basically how you create a file. If you want to save it, you press escape, you press colon, and you press W for write, and then Q for quit, and then exclamation mark. So that's basically how you save a file. So if I enter now, the file is saved. If I want to go view it, I can say test one, which is the file name. I didn't give it another name. And then it will show me all my contents there that I showed earlier. All right, so that's basically how you would then, you know, do it in that essence. So when I want to edit the file, you know, I can go into the file and edit it. So the other editor is vim. So vim, if I do vim test one, it will be slightly different, not the same. But you can see now you would still have access to the file, the type, and you can still go there. But now with vim, you have to press I for insert in order for this command to change to insert. With vi, you don't have to put I, it's already there to do that. So that's one way of how you can do, there's two different editors, right? So that's like text editors. So I can now save that, and then I know I've edited the file. So if I go view it now, there will be nothing because I just cleared everything with using vim. There's another command which is called, it's vim, it's vi, and I think it's called nano. So there's a nano editor. And the nano editor does the same. So if you go to test one, then this is what it would look like, right? So it's test one. And so with nano, it's a bit tricky, but it gives you the instructions what to do. You can type the same stuff there in the nano editor file, right? But when you save it, you don't save like I save now with WQ and exclamation mark. You press Control and zero. And that is basically the save command. Then you press enter to save it. As you can see at the bottom, it says to write out is that command. So the shift there means actually control or shift. But you write that command there, you press that character and that to write out to save. That's the term. And then if you want to exit, you press that command and the X letter on your keyboard. So now to exit, I press that command. And then I'm out of the nano editor. So that's one editor. And if I want to go view it, then you can see those were added. So there's three different editors that you can use in Linux. The most common is vim and vi. But nano is also one of them. If you have a low-end operating system of Linux, you would use nano. All right. So that is this part that I wanted to show you here. So there's the parts that I wanted to show you, which I just did now. So there's vim. So the vim part where you can actually list certain things. And then those are just cursor controls. But this is basically what I did now. I use vim text.txt and I could then enter content if I need to. And then it creates a new file. And then you basically just press insert. You can either use any of these characters to use the insert mode. So it's I, A, O, or any of that order. You can use any of that order. Is my network really bad? But I'm on fiber. It's weird. No, it's because of UDP. It's not my network. It's this whole thing of the streaming, and we've been streaming long. Yeah. So I think that is what I wanted to cover on with regard to the concept of Linux. So I think it's on your side, maybe. Yeah, on your end. Like that. Remember when I spoke to you about UDP? UDP traffic is connectionless. It doesn't care about your end. So what you see is you see kind of blurry things, or you could not hear my audio, and that would be packets dropping on your end. So it's actually your service provider, and connecting to this particular application that we're using for the Wii meeting. And because it's UDP, it doesn't care about us. You know, it's just trying to stream what we're streaming, at the faster rate. Okay, so that is just commands in Linux if you want to query an IP address. So let's say I clear the screen and I want to, you know, do an IP config. Then what I will do is I'll just type ifconfig, and in Windows you would use the command ipconfig. So that will tell me what my network address or devices on my network. So in this case, I'm on a 192, so my network address would be right here on top. I have virtual machines running, that's why you see all these virtual devices. But my network should be somewhere. Where's my 192 IP? It could be right at the bottom. That's a page, that's a bridge. I don't know where my network is, it's somewhere. But I think that's a bridge network that I have there. So I've got a lot of things running on my device. So you know, because of virtualization that I'm doing VMware and that, so it will you will see a lot of networks here, so don't worry about that. But I was just trying to see what's my IP, and I still can't find it. Anyway, maybe it's somewhere configured differently. Anyway, so that's ipconfig. But if you do just a normal ifconfig, maybe it's because I used a let's clear the screen. Let's do ifconfig a just so. Then basically it will show you your devices again. Maybe it will show it now. No, it still shows the bridge. Anyway. Okay, so let's clear the screen. So there's another way also you can see IP address. It's called IP address. So you do IP address, and then you say so, and that will, sorry, that will be normally working in Linux. Now, because I've got the Mac, it's not gonna work. If I have a Linux machine, I could be able to see the IP address. So those are commands only made for Linux and not for on the Mac. So those are ways of how you can view certain things. So if I wanted to view a certain host portion, then I will just put the interface ID there, and then it will show me that. Right, so these are also information that you see in Linux, which they have in this study three-part there, which is the etc folder, sysconfig, and then you have the ifconfig files there that you can actually go modify. So sometimes you would want to boot your network device or your server as a IP address only and not DHCP. So you would then change that to static. So this is basically an example of using it as static, and you basically add your IP address there, what you want the IP address to be, the server IP, the net mask, the device network that you're going to configure it on, and also the network NIC that is on. And that you have to save, restart your network config, and then check if the network is up. And if it's up, it will show you that you successfully added a static IP address, which is that one, to that particular device wherever you configure it. And in most cases, you want to have a static IP because you know the network changes IPs every 15 days. So you don't want to have a server that everybody connects to where the IP changes after 15 days, and then you have to go back and reconfigure certain things. So that's basically that part. So again, some of these commands are not shown on my Mac. I need to connect to a Linux machine, and then I can do some of that commands. So the IP root is basically just to show you what's your root that you're on. So in this case, if I don't know if this command will work here, but we'll see. It doesn't. It just give me reuse. So if that doesn't give me much, I need to specify more arguments, more modifiers, more things. So that won't work. So I'm not gonna even try that now here. But on a Linux machine, this would work. And here you can add a static root also, a root, a default root also, not a static root, default root to a network that you want to go to. And that you can do in Linux. You can also delete a root also if you configure the wrong static root. You can also delete that root also. And then also if you want to change your host name of your device, you can do that using the viewing it. You can do cat command. So normally, I'm not sure if Linux has it, but we can say cat etc. And then let's see if host name picks up. Okay, I've got host only. But I don't think maybe I've got host name. No, it doesn't have Mac doesn't have host name. So you only have the host file, which basically shows you what's in that host file. So here I've done I added some host because I wanted to test something. So what you can do is you can add host statically or manually. That will almost like being that you're going to the internet. And so I did that because I wanted to see how Parallels work, which is a virtualization software. And then again, I just wanted to see basically can, I add it as a local host. So that's one way where you can add more multiple hosts. And you could say host name, and this is the host name here currently, or you can change the host name to Huawei. And so next time you print host name, it will be Huawei and not that. Right. So there you see the host file that I just showed you now on my side. So the host file would be where all the, if the computer has to resolve an IP address to a DNS name, it will use the host file also to do that. So there you can see there's the IP domain. So there's 192.168.10.20, and then that's the example of a domain. So if you type www.example.com, you would resolve to that IP there on your local host, in that case, if you have a server. All right, so that was a bit of operating system basics, mostly on the Linux side. I think it's 12 o'clock already. I needed to get to virtualization, so I'll see. And then obviously when you look at this, so the answer here would be C in this case, because we want to see which of the following is not correct about file system. So a file system is a method that's used by always to identify files. So that is wrong. The software structure that manages your your store your files is wrong as a file system. Now that's also wrong. The file system manage controls computer hardware resources. That's correct. And the file system organize and allocate space. No, that's wrong. Remember that is your task of your OS. Okay. Linux is a multi-user OS that allows multiple users to log in at the same time. That is correct. You can log in as multiple users on the same Linux via the the terminal, and then no one will know that you logged in unless you check the logs and check the counter and journal counters and that. All right, so that basically is just a basic summary of OS and basics, and that basically is where we're at. So virtualization is where we want to explore. So I'll see if I can, spend another 30 minutes, on that, and then see really how we can finish off with this. I see there was chats about is this compulsory? It's more or less the cloud basics. If you want to explore, let me just see what was the question. There's no final exam, there is a mock exam. If you do the mock exam at the bottom, you'll see there's a final exam. I think there was a question in the chat. They must do the final exam in order if I want to now look at, if you want a voucher. Like I said, there's 19 vouchers. Vouchers expire in the year. It's the quicker you apply, the better. Although we're doing cloud basics, hopefully you can go learn about virtualization, Huawei virtualization on your own time and prepare well in advance for that particular exam. All right, so that is the summary of this. So let me get on to the other part. I'll just stop sharing and I'll let the recording run. Unless I let me just break this up 29 minutes on operating system basics, so I'll just stop it there.